Welcome to this session of Class 9 Mathematics, and I am here Anu from MathSchool.1. Last class it was Euclid's Geometry, and this class will be a continuation of the chapter, that is Chapter 5. Okay, so last class we saw Euclid's Geometry, and we saw Euclid, the mathematician who is also the father of geometry. Actually, he was a Greek mathematician, and in those days, Greeks were the first to reason out the truth behind the geometrical construction. Okay, so what he did was, he compiled all the works of his forefathers and he made a treatise called Elements. And in these Elements were divided into 13 chapters, and each chapter became books. And in those books, if you see, 1 to 4 and 6 were based on solid geometry, and 1 to 4 and 6, what we are seeing here is of plane geometry, and 5 and 7 to 10 chapters are based on, that is, the books are based on the number theory, and 11 to 18 it is full of solid geometry. Okay, so now according to our chapter, we are going to see Euclid's theorems and axioms regarding plane geometry. Okay, so he actually followed this series, which is solids to surfaces and then to lines up to points. So what does this the series means is, solids, he took solids as the space which can be moved from one place to another. So it was defined by some area or by some space which can be moved from one place to another, and these solids were made up of surfaces, and these surfaces had boundaries, okay, which separated one surface from another, and those boundaries were called lines. The surfaces meet at boundaries which are called lines, and those lines have end points. Okay, so the end points, the point we know, so that is E from each and every thing, we, if you see, there is a reduction in extension, that is the dimension reduces. Solid has three dimensions, length, breadth and height, isn't it? But the surfaces have length and breadth only, and a line has just the length, and point is dimensionless. So this is what we saw in the last class, and we call this Euclid's geometry, or the system of Euclid's geometry, as axiomatic system. So what do we mean by axiomatic system? Actually, what are all the facts, or what are all the theories founded by his forefathers? Euclid collected everything together, he compiled everything together, and he tried to reason out the truth behind it, and he divided those into axioms and postulates. So what do we mean by axioms? Axioms are just facts, basic facts, and without any proof. They were accepted without any proof, and the geometrical ideas which we can see throughout maths. Okay, so these are axioms, are basic facts, and they don't need any proof, particularly any proof. So some of the axioms he has given are, see, things which are equal to the same thing. So let me explain it. So things which are equal to the same thing are equal to one another. It is just like, I'll give an example for the one of the axioms. See, things which are equal to the same thing. So if A is equal to B, and if I say B is equal to C, isn't it? If things are, that is A and C are some things, and those things are equal to the same thing, then the things are equal to one another. That is, we write A is equal to C. A is equal to B and B is equal to C, then A is equal to C. So this is what this an axiom means, and this doesn't need any proof, and this is accepted throughout. This is universal truths. Actually, these are called obviously universal truth what Euclid has given, and those axioms and postulates together, they were all called obvious universal truths, and among them axioms, they don't need any specific proof. Okay, so one among them is, if things are equal to same thing, then they are equal to one another. Then the next one is, if equals are added to equals, so if like these equals are added to equals, then the wholes will be equal. So if A is equal to B, B is equal to C, and A is equal to C, and if I add A plus B plus C, then that is equal to A plus B plus C. See left side, A plus B plus C I add, you get A plus B plus C. Okay, A plus B plus C. Do you understand? So when equals are added to equals, the wholes are also equal. Likewise, if equals are subtracted from equals, then the remainders are also equal. So this is one of the axiom. And then the other axiom is, if things coincide with each other, okay, certain things coincide with each other, then they are equal to one another. So what does it mean? Let us take concurrent lines. Okay, so they coincide with each other. Each line, when it is perfectly placed on the other line, then they are equal to one another. So if things are if things coincide with each other, then they are equal to one another. Okay, then the next thing is, we definitely know this, that is the whole, we take a whole part, a big one, a large one, which is a whole thing, and that whole is definitely larger than the part. So this is also an axiom. And the other one is, if things are equal to double of some other things. See, if I write A is equal to 2B and C is also equal to 2. So what do I say? If things are equal to double of some other things, the same thing, double, 2B is 2B, if it is equated to some other things, A and C, if they are equated to the same thing, which is double, then A and C are equal to each other. Okay, do you understand? So things which are equated, which are equal to double the same thing, then the things are equal to one another. Likewise, the same axiom is applied to when things are equal to half of the same things. That is half of same things. If it is not 2b, if it is b by 2, then the things are equal to one another. Okay, do you understand? So those are axioms. Those are basic facts which doesn't need further proof. So they were accepted as they were, and they didn't need, Euclid didn't need so much of reasoning to prove these axioms. He took it as it is. Okay. On the other hand, he developed some other axioms called incidence axioms. So from these, what we understand is there is a link between line and points. He correlated lines and points together and gave us some incidence axioms, which resulted in more theorems or more facts which are followed even today in geometry. Okay, so those were called incidence axioms. And what do those incidence axioms tell us? So what do they tell us is, there are, first one is, there are infinitely many points in a line. So we accept it even now, isn't it? So there are infinitely many points in a line. Okay, and what do we say is, a line, we always define a line see a line has end points, isn't it? A, B, it has end points. So if at all I have a straight line, then it has two end points in it. Okay, so two end points. If it has two end points, then it is called a line. We call it now as a line segment, but Euclid termed it as a terminated line. Okay, so this was called as terminated lines. And he also said, if at all lines meet, lines intersect one another, then they meet only at a only at one point. So what do we understand from this? There can be many lines passing through a single point. So lines which meet each other have just only one point in common. So those, when that led to the concept of intersecting lines, isn't it? So these were some of the incident axioms which Euclid mentioned, and this was further developed for us to understand about collinear points. So what are collinear points? Collinear points are those points which lie on the straight, on a single line, isn't it? On the same line. So we call them collinear points. If a line has all the points in it, so we call those points in a line as collinear points. Okay, so what about concurrent lines then? Concurrent lines are those lines. See, what are concurrent lines? If we trace a line, or if we trace a line and put it on the other line or the given line, it is superimposed on the same line. It is exactly the same. When one line is superimposed on the other line, then they both are exactly the same. It appears to be exactly the same. Then those lines are for concurrent lines. So how did Euclid define those concurrent lines? He said, when there is a point which lies on all the lines, a single point which lies on all the lines, then those lines are called concurrent lines. So that is how he joined, combined the concept of points and lines together to explain various concepts of lines. And now we have done with the concurrent lines, collinear points, isn't it? So the next one comes the parallel and intersecting lines. Okay, so he also defined some theorem, he also explained some concepts or facts, and he proved some concepts regarding parallel and intersecting lines. We'll see some of them. So we are going to see about parallel and intersecting lines, isn't it? So as it was said previously, there is a single point through which many lines can pass, isn't it? So these are called intersecting lines. Now, what are parallel lines? Parallel lines are lines which don't have any common point like this. It doesn't meet anywhere. So, there is no common point for parallel lines. It doesn't meet anywhere. So, it doesn't have any common point among them. So, which doesn't have common points? Lines which don't have any common point are called parallel lines. And intersecting lines have a single common point through which all the lines pass. Okay, so this was the first theorem. Then the next one is, what are parallel lines? He went on to explain about the parallel lines. So parallel lines, if two lines, say L and M, okay, or let us take L and N. So this L and N, if they are parallel to a given line, to another line M. See, if L is parallel to, so this is a symbol of parallel, L is parallel to M and N is also parallel to M. Okay, if two lines are parallel to another line, the third line, then we say that the first and the second line are parallel to each other. That is, if L is parallel to M and N is parallel to M, then L is parallel to M. Okay, so this, how did Euclid prove, is through the method of contradiction. So what is the method of contradiction? We say the theorem and we just take the opposite of it. That is, we contradict the statement. That is, we say that L and M intersect. Okay. So L and M intersect. If L and M intersect, so they should have a common point, isn't it? If L and M intersect, they should have a common point. Let us take, sorry, if L and N, L is parallel to N is the theorem, isn't it? L is parallel to N is the theorem. So let us take L and N intersect. So this is my statement of contradiction, L and N intersect. Now what we need to do is, we say L is parallel to M. Okay, so L is parallel to M I have taken, and N is parallel to M I have taken. But if these two are parallel to the single line M, then what should this L and N be? L should be parallel to N, isn't it? But it is intersecting. So it is not true. So we say that L is parallel to N. So by method of contradiction, L is parallel to N and L doesn't intersect N. Okay, so this is how he proved that L, if two lines are parallel to third line, then they are parallel to each other. So this is regarding parallel lines. And next is the intersecting lines. See, if I have two lines here, okay, and I have an, there are two lines L and M, and I have an intersecting line P. So if a line P intersects L, okay, if a line P intersects L, and if L is parallel to M, see L and M are parallel, and if L is parallel to M, then the line P also intersects M. Okay. So L is parallel to M and P intersects L, then this P, the line P also intersects M. So how did he prove that? So let us take L intersects P, L intersects P, and P and M are parallel. P and M are parallel. So let it be. So I assume it. So let P be parallel to M. So if P is parallel to M, isn't it? We should not have any common point. If P is parallel to M, we should not have any common point. But what is given here is P intersects L. So if P intersects L, P is not parallel to L, isn't it? If P intersects L, P is not parallel to L because it has a common point. And given that L is parallel to M, see, L is parallel to M. If L is parallel to M and L intersects P, then it should also pass M, isn't it? See, if we suppose that P is parallel to M, there should not be any common point between them. But what is given here is L is parallel to M, so naturally P intersects M also. So there is a common point between P and M. So this is not true. P is not parallel to M and P intersects M also. You understand? So this is one of the theorem he proved. And regarding the intersecting lines, we have another theorem. See, let us take this to be L and M. And if I have a line P here, okay, so this is a line P here, it intersects L and M. Okay, L and M are parallel. Okay, L and M are parallel. And we have another line called Q here. So there is a line Q here, and P is parallel to Q also. Okay, so P is parallel to Q. Then what happens is, I say Q also intersects M. See, P intersects L and M, and L and M are parallel to each other, then Q also intersects M. So how it is? See, L and M are parallel to each other, and P intersects both L and M. Okay, So P intersects L and M. It has common points with L and M. It intersects L and M. And then Q intersects L, we see. See, Q intersects L. Since L and M are parallel, Q is extended. See, if Q is extended, you see Q also intersects M, isn't it? So P is parallel to Q. Or if P is parallel to Q and L is parallel to M, then Q intersects M. Anyway around, we have Q intersecting M and P and Q being parallel to each other. So since P and Q are parallel to each other, L and M are parallel to each other, and P intersects L and M, Q also intersects M. Do you understand? So this is how this was proved. And the last one is, see, if you have two lines and you have a point here, see, A, B, C, D, E are 5 points on the line. You have two lines, so let this be L and M. Okay, so if at all there are two lines parallel and there are 5 points on the line L, then we say that A, B, C, D, E are collinear. Okay, so how did he say that these 5 points are collinear? So let us take line AB alone. Let us take line AB is parallel to M. Let us take. Then next is line AC to be parallel with M. Then next line AD to be parallel with M. And next line AE to be parallel with M. We take it separately. But what we have studied earlier, what did Euclid explain us earlier, was that should be only one line passing through a point which is parallel. That should be only one point in a line. See, there is only one line, one line passing through a point which is parallel to a given line. Okay, so that there should be only one line parallel to M passing through a given point. So if I take A to be the point and the line drawn through A, that is the L line drawn through A, it is parallel to M, then there should not be any other line, any other line passing through A which is parallel to M. It can't be, isn't it? So through A, if I draw some lines like this, these lines won't be parallel with M. Only the line L is parallel with M, isn't it? So the points lying on L are definitely collinear, isn't it? Because they all lie on the line L. So A, B, C, D, E are collinear. So that is how he explained the axioms, that is the incident axioms and the theorems regarding parallel and intersecting lines. You understand? So these are some of the axioms which were given by Euclid. In the next class, we will be seeing his famous theorems, the 5 theorems, out of which the 5th theorem is still under much discussions, which is called the theorem of parallelism, and we'll be seeing that too in the next class. So until then, keep watching. It's Anu for MaxBoldt.com. Thank you.